afternoon. It's always very difficult to be the first speaker, have to kind of break through this nap and right after lunch. So anyway, I'm trying to be as attending as possible, but let's see how well I can do this, okay? So I think in my introduction, you probably heard that I am more of a scientist rather than truly operational type of, or CEO type of operations. And no, I'm not at all. Actually, I feel very honored to be invited today to speak on this topic. But over the last, I would say, 15, 16 years, I have the privilege to work with many C-suite leaders. So a lot of my data point actually coming from them directly. So I will share what I learned with you. And obviously, I think this is a very intimate setting. We could do a bit of exchange afterwards. That would be fantastic. So I want to start by talking about there's a chart in show up. It should be supposed to be a diagram in the show. Anyway, okay. So well, I want to start by talking about the complexity, change, and challenges. I think in recent years, you could hardly start any discussion about leadership without dealing with those three C's. I call them the three C's: complexity, changes, and challenges. And we heard about change become constant. We talk about complexity is the biggest headache for CEOs. But the truth is that those three things have been in existence since leadership is in existence. In other words, it's been there for a long, long time. The difference is that the speed of change and the scale impact have changed quite a lot. And so to deal with those issues, we cannot ignore the fact that CEOs are really, really distracted by so many other priorities in their job. So I personally would like to honor that first. And I have not met one CEO or one leader really not want to focus on the safety and health. So that's something I want to really just, you know, set the stage for the rest of my sharing. So, but then if we talk about risk, if the leader's job, we talk about leader in terms of not only the CEO, but all the way to the shop floor, the supervisors, if their job really is just to mitigate risk, their job will be at least a little bit easier. But the truth is that obviously they are looking at the risk and threat, they also need to look at the rewards and gains, the profit. They also need to look into opportunities for improvement. What are opportunities? So as a CEO, you also need to look at what is the outlook, what opportunities that my company can grow into. So there are multiple things that we look at. So this is another chart. I think it's the version. Okay. Great. So I'm going to start with this chart, okay? This is supposed to be a very straight triangle, so I'm sorry, this I think the compatibility is our issues. So in order to optimize operations, okay, in vision, please tell me a little bit here. This chart is supposed to be straight before they get crooked, okay? Business leader needs to set visions. Vision doesn't change very much. You need to see what is the purpose of the business, right? It doesn't change much. But then the rest of the stuff, the strategies, how do you operate? Everything needs to be able to be aligned with that vision constantly. But now we look at all the changes. Dealing with all the changes, how do we navigate? So in this case, alignment is important, but agility is equally critical. That's why this concept about alignment and agility become a very focal point of all my research. Okay, so I want to kind of share that as well. But what is really, how do we describe alignment and agility? So this term about adaptive. We want company to be able to be adaptive, be able to, let's define it a little bit together, being able to make decisions and execute them in real time, in a real time basis, and based on information that's readily at hand, in order to produce the best outcome at the time. And this is constant. They do that every single day. And this is not only about CEOs, but also about supervisors, and every day when they do operations. So if we put our mind into that realm, in terms of we need to constantly be adaptive. In order for us to move ahead in alignment as well as with agility, that's the key. In everything we deal with and we deal with risk, the adaptive nature of things, the requirement to be adaptive is a very important key component in our discussion about leadership. Now, I think I would like to use my computer if the organizer doesn't mind. because none of the charge are run correctly. So it's it's very. Can you guys see this? There's a lot of graphic been lost. All right. Let me see how far I can go because there's a lot of important ingredients and a lot. All right. So this chart actually coming from John Carter, the book about leading change. Okay. So talking about in order to be adaptive, we need to leverage both the management skill set and leadership skill set. A lot of times in organization, those two skill sets are combined, and sometimes they are separated. Difference between president and CEOs, difference between CEO and the COOs. So, but at the end of the day, they need to build the synergy. The reason they need to build synergy is because management produces stability, produces predictability, produces expectation. People know what to expect, what are the right way to do things. That's what management's job is, right? So, provide the consistency across. So, but on the other hand, in order to have the change, to produce change, this is where the leadership comes in. Be able to inspire people, motivate people, provide them a purpose, be able to communicate that purpose. So the synergy between management and leadership. They are everyday leaders that are there. When they need opinion, when they need directions, those are people who provide immediate answer, immediate opinion. Those are what we call the grassroots leaders. Engage them could help us reduce the power distance to build that trust, everyday trust. So leadership, how do you embrace them, engage them? How do you empower them? Become very critical. It's difficult to empower everybody all at one shot, but being able to identify the grassroots leader, embrace them, give them the power. It's a very, very important dance. Next step. So at the end of engaging grassroots leader, that's what we want. We want management commitment and involvement from grassroots, all the way to management become more involved and grassroots become more committed. That's the art of this journey in terms of building culture. Sorry, two more points. Okay, number three is respect your organizational intelligence. Sorry, I used too much time. Here is the flowchart. This is the management process. After studying more than 300 slides, this is probably one of the most comprehensive is the management process that we identified. So very, very elaborate process. But there are elephants in this process. Leaders need to ask this kind of question. Where is the weakest link? You know, when you look at this chart, what's the problem? What's the implication? What are the critical messages? In conducting workshop with those leaders, I show them those charts. I challenge them. What do you see? What question do you want to ask? And the discussion, it tells a lot about the culture and whether the leaders care or not. Number four is to start keystone habit. Keystone habit is the habit that's visible, that's systematic, that everybody could do and everybody could see the results. How do you identify keystone habit? Like Alcoa, identify safety as their keystone habit. Like Alpine, would it, they change their TIR from 5 to 0.2 in 5 years because they identify well-being or EHS first as their keystone habit. Schneider does the same thing with focusing on the well-being alone. I would love to talk to you guys about this.